Hey guys, BugCat7 here. Okay, it is Friday, September the 18th, 2020, and I want to thank you for visiting the Stonewall Research Channel here on YouTube. I really do appreciate it. All right, guys, well, I'm going to continue with part two of my series, looking into the quote-unquote giants, or large hominids, as I like to call them, international. And in this video, we are going to cover Patagonia. Now, Patagonia is very interesting in itself, and it seems to be largely ignored by mainstream academics by the simple fact that it's best known for the large-sized people that were found there when the explorers found this place, which is really just a sparsely populated country in South America. Okay, who knows what it was at the time of the explorers. Apparently, the Americas were filled with a lot more people than you can possibly imagine. Even the Spanish historians have noted that the conquistadors killed something like 14 million to 19 million people in Central America. That's million people, okay? So 19 million people, 14 million people. I mean, you know, there was a lot of people in the Americas here, folks. That's why the whole thing with, you know, Phoenicians and Egyptians and Celts and Vikings and Asians and whoever setting up colonies here is extremely remote, okay? If anything, like I said, they garrisoned the places where they were going to do trade, because of the mechanics of trade. I don't want to get into it now. But it's interesting that Patagonia is known for these extra large sized people and the history of it and the name of it and everything. And, you know, just that simple fact lends credence to the whole giant issue and everything else. So I just want to read to you from Wikipedia, the Baloney Online Encyclopedia, what they have in here, okay? As far as the only thing that began through the history of this is through the etymology. The name Patagonia comes from the word Patagon, which they're not explaining what that means. Magellan used this term in 1520 to describe the native tribes of the region whom his expedition thought to be giants, okay? So this is Magellan's term, okay, to describe these people as being giants. So Patagon means a giant. Okay, they're not saying giant foot or anything like that, but that's what we heard it was in other researchers' opinions. The people he called the Patagons are now believed to have been the Tehuelche, who tended to be taller than the Europeans at the time. Okay, so the Europeans at the time, and I did all the research on this, all the Europeans before 1800, the average size was somewhere between 5'3" and 5'5", okay? Forget what kind of centimeters we're talking about. It's like 160-something centimeters, very short and stout people. And up until this time, most of the native tribes that they had run into were of rather short stature as well. But they find these rather taller than European people at the time. Okay, well, what they're not telling you here in Wikipedia, even though they'll host the whole thing on the research of the growth of people and height, the history of height right here, which I've covered on my own channel, okay? There's no explanation for it, okay? According to their science, according to mainstream academics and everything, there has to be an explanation for this, okay? Because it doesn't coincide with what they believe and hold to be true about how people grow in height, okay? There's no reason why these people would be extra tall or anything else. There's no explanation for it. They assume that everybody would be of average height at the time because of such and such and such reasons, many of them having to do with diet and health, okay? So the advanced cultures in Europe were, you know, thought to be of superior health than these people with the Aboriginal peoples. Well, if that's true, then, you know, why were these people so tall? So, in any case, Argentine researcher Miguel Dora observed the name Patagonia possibly derives from the ancient Greek region of modern Turkey called Paphlagonia, possible home of the Patagon personage in the chivalric romances Premilion, printed in 1512, 10 years before Magellan arrived in these southern lands. This hypothesis was published in a 2011 New Review of Spanish Philology report. Okay, so they don't even really know where the word was derived from and all this kind of stuff. There's so much mystery that surrounds this, but let's look at some of these accounts here. And one particular one is noted for Patagonia here, and this Capdois, the 12-foot, two-headed giant. Okay, this is Chris Leslie on Greater Ancestors. See, I also found this Capdois, the two-headed Patagonian giant, over 12 feet tall. He was captured by Spanish sailors in 1673. After he'd killed four of them, his captors plunged a boarding pike through his heart. His stuffed body has been on display in English sideshows since 1900 and in America since 1980. That's the Fortean Times. Okay, and here's an illustration of him here. 12 feet tall. It's making the other guys in the illustration look even smaller. And here's more info. The two-headed Patagonian giant was over 12 feet tall, 3.7 meters tall, was a famous fairground attraction brought to England in the 19th century. He had been captured by the Spanish sailors in 1673 and bound to the mainmast. He broke loose and killed four of his captors before being killed himself by a boarding pike punched into his heart. In the early 1900s, the stuffed giant was portrayed by Mr. Bartram, who toured the country on the Edwardian horror circuit, ending up in Weston-super-Mare in Somerset, where the curiosity passed through several hands and exhibited at various locations. It was known as Capdois, which translates approximately as two heads. In the Malay language, Kepala means head and Dua means two. How this relates to the Patagonian provenance is unknown. Okay, so what I didn't mention in that Wikipedia article is that they really don't know what the etymology, the philology there is of it. And they just have no idea. And because the people who spoke the languages, the tribes there, when they actually found it there, when the settlers came back, okay, there were different people, spoke a different language altogether. In 1914, visitors on to Weston's Birnbeck Pier paid tuppence to see the black giant lying on his back wearing a loincloth, armed with a large club and snake coiled on his breast. The exhibit is mentioned in the Innkeeper's Diary, 1931, by John Fothergill, and Cider with Rosie, 1959, by Laurie Lee. It was sold to a showman called Lord Thomas Howard in 1959, after which it left Weston. Frank Ady remembers seeing it in a black pool in Blackpool around 1960. There was nosing of sutures and other joints, even though the body was largely unclothed. In the 1930s, two doctors and a radiologist inspected it in Weston and found no perceptual evidence of it being a fake. They speculated it was some kind of a conjoined twin. It was again on display in Blackpool at the end of 1960. One account maintains that in 1974, Howard sold or transferred Capdois to his brother Scott in New Jersey. The two-headed giant in a glass case with a coil snake in a club was seen at a traveling fun fair in Manchester in November 1998. Ian Simmons then asked Professor Stumball about Capdois. Stumball, one of the last of the British freak show showmen, Billy Hill, had bought the giant from Howard in Blackpool, and though semi-retired, still toured in his white bus with an assortment of attractions, including the two-headed boy, the smallest woman that ever lived, the six-legged lamb, a three-eyed fox. Last heard, he kept Capdois in Newcastle in September 1999. Mr. Horn in Baltimore has tracked a dubious relic this year in a Baltimore antique shop called Antique Man One. Okay, so what's interesting to me about this is that, first of all, if you don't believe that a two-headed something could exist, a two-headed human being can exist, all you need to see is this film right here on Abigail and Brittany Hensel, the twins who share a body. This is actually a two-headed person. Okay, these girls, which you have to admire for their courage and accomplishments, just amazing. Okay, this two-headed girl. If you don't see it, you'll be fascinated by this video if you haven't seen it. And unbelievable. And I'll put a link to it at the end of this video, but just amazing. All right. So, in any case, there you have in modern times a perfect example of there existing a two-headed person. So, it's not something that's just totally unbelievable, it's completely believable. Just look at this. Okay. So, in any case, let's move on. And this again, just to demonstrate, I'm not going to read it because it's just a brief mention in here of this patois going around in carnivals. And what I really want to make note about is that it was very difficult to come up with a complete specimen of a giant, so therefore they were rare. And if they were found complete, they were often put on display and brought around to these fairs, etc. So, and shows and whatnot. So there goes the train, freight train. Yep, a lot of cars, probably full. I can feel it. So, in any case, the point that I'm making here is that if a complete body, mummified body of a giant was ever found, these were scoffed up and bought. I mean, they were all being sold left and right, as we read in the accounts before. Okay, these things were sold and put up as attractions all over the place throughout Europe and the United States, etc. But it was rare to find one, and that's why these things were put on display and everything as rarities. Okay, so just to demonstrate that these things were bought and sold all over the place, and what became of them after the interest died off, or the whole program to eradicate any notion of there ever being giant people being put forth by people like Alice Herdlischka and C.W. Holmes of the Smithsonian Bureau of Ethnology. Okay, their program to eradicate these thoughts in education, etc., was pretty successful. Okay. And unfortunately, these things were left to, rot or whatever. And, people just lost track of them and disappeared and thrown in the garbage or whatever it is, most likely, which is just a black eye on the past there. When people at the time, there were people who existed at the time, could have done something about it, they didn't, because it didn't further their interests in it. And because they all were behind Darwin's theories 100%. So people couldn't have been large and then grown smaller. That doesn't follow. It's supposed to be smaller and getting bigger, as they report from 1800. Okay, we've all grown, our human race has grown by 10 centimeters, but we've stopped growing for some reason. And that baffles them. They can't figure that out, why that's happening. Giant size human skeleton in Port Desire. Giant size human skeleton. Early Spanish colonized activities around Port Desire in Patagonia, Argentina, in parentheses, were made familiar to Europeans by a large engraving. A part of that display shows two men slaying a lion, while behind them, in an area designated as H, diggers have unearthed a giant sized human skeleton. And they show it in this illustration here. Report of the mound explorations of the Bureau of Ethnology. Okay. And here's the illustration. Okay. So, always these Bureau of Ethnologies that were happy to unearth these skeletal remains, and ones being intact, well, they were promptly seized and disappeared. And you got to ask yourself why. The Beagle confirms giants in Patagonia. Charles Darwin sees giants. The Beagle, under the command of Captain Robert Fitzroy, left Devonport, England on 27 December 1831 with a team of botanists, naturalists, physicists, among whom was Charles Darwin. The British crowned this expedition, sponsored the scientific and geographical exploration. They passed the Canary Islands and crossed the Atlantic to reach the Brazilian coast. After continuing to explore the Strait of Magellan and landed in Patagonia to check the veracity of the chronicles of Antonio Pigafetta, it was one of the 18 survivors of the first circumnavigation of the Earth, begun by Ferdinand Magellan and completed by Juan Sebastian Elcano. Besides that, these chronicles of the Patagonians were giants with big feet. When they lay, their feet are shaded. But by contrast, the women were much lower and fat, with big breasts falling. From Charlie's own lips, Charles Darwin proved greater ancestry in the case of humans. He claimed that himself and the entire crew and the captain, that the people they saw were the tallest known in the world. Therefore, the people of that region are rather short today, which demonstrates greater ancestry as a fact for this region when it comes to human population. Charles Darwin did see an above average people in height, as there were many tall tribes in that region. The passengers of the Beagle never saw the Patagonians. Charles Darwin mentions the average height being 6 feet, including women and young adults. Darwin's lack of details intentionally leaves out the maximum height and how much taller men of the tribe were. We thank Charles Darwin for this little bit of confirmation of the tallest race anywhere, which have shrunk in modern times, thus confirming greater ancestry. And Chris Leslie is all about this greater ancestry, so, you know. Yeah, well, many of his thoughts coincide with my own, but others, no, but it doesn't matter. I think he's mostly on the right track with this from a scientific point of view. Enormous human craniums. A party of Italian scientists who recently explored Patagonia found in that country large numbers of enormous human craniums. There were evidently no polo or bicycle clubs in Patagonia. Stab at the Italians there. For no reason, okay? Maybe making fun of anybody finding these remains. You know, a lot of that, you had two sides to that whole thing, the people who supported it and the people who were against it. And this was all put together with, the petrified remains found in North America and all the stuff that was found out to be hoaxes. Like the Cardiff Giant in New York, which I go over on this channel, was an intentional plot to discredit the Giants. And they did a pretty good job of it with that, okay? The whole backstory is a bunch of nonsense made up to protect these guys who are in on this whole thing, onto this psychological operation to turn everybody against the validity of the Giants. Okay, so any case, those were just a few of the accounts. I'm sure there were many more accounts in all of South America and the Americas in whole, even North America, many accounts that we don't know about because they just haven't been researched out thoroughly, or perhaps, you know, these publications didn't keep any microfiche or any sort of records or anything that we can't go through now and find out about. So, anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed that little bit there, and just think about it, you know, especially with Cop Bois, and, you know, the thing with there being a two-headed giant, and it would be so bizarre and unbelievable, but it's not unbelievable, because you gotta check out these girls, okay, in two people in one body, okay? And if it can exist today, it can exist back then, and it can exist in giants as well. Okay? It's not completely far-fetched. And when you see this documentary, you'll be on the edge of your seat the whole entire time watching it, because it's amazing. All right, guys. Anyway, hope you enjoyed the video. Please hit the like button. And if you're not a sub, please do subscribe. We're going to go into a lot more interesting things in the future. All right? All right, guys. Anyway, BudCat7 signing out. Peace.